Hello friends, Usha Pandit, your Mindsprings English teacher. Today we are going to do how to describe settings. Very, very important. Settings has a big impact on several parts of your story, okay? You don't have to write a very long setting, but what you write has to be good enough to touch many of these things that I'm going to talk to you about. All of this is coming to you from Writing with Ease. I've literally used my book in order to make this lesson so that you have an idea of what it contains. So what we have is settings here, and if you look at the red marks, it is about place, which is where, it is about time, which is when, and then you have the genre. What the setting does is it actually affects your genre. So if you are going to write a comic story or a mystery story or a ghost story, your setting needs to make it happen right at the beginning. You cannot give your reader any shocks, okay? And then you have, with time, you have history. You have the political and social conditions of a place, which sounds very big. But when you talk about it, when you come down to it, you just realize that it's just basically talking about what the times were. It just adds an extra flavor to your writing and makes it more interesting. Otherwise, it becomes a baby story. So especially if you're in middle school, add a little bit of flavor to your stories. So let's take it one by one, and then of course you have tools, which I shall talk about, and diction. So place is essentially where. And how do you describe place? You describe the geography. So you don't have to go into a huge description of Africa. You shouldn't, because then your word limit is going to go for a toss. You just need a very short description, then you can intersperse that setting throughout your story. That's the way to do it. So the geography, you need to decide whether it's a real place or whether it's an imaginary place, which means what sort of a story are you writing? What is your genre? Are you writing science fiction? Are you writing a historical account? What are you doing? So the geography will decide how your story is going to progress. These are things for you to have a think before you start writing, okay? And the next one in place is landscape. You need a landscape, don't you? So obviously, if you're in Africa, you'll have the plains of Africa. And if you're in the polar regions, then you'll have ice all around you. And if you're in a village in North India, it will have a certain sort of flora and fauna. So there might be certain landscapes where there are rivers or there are ravines or there are crocodiles or alligators or certain kinds of flowering bushes. All of these will add wonderful color to your setting. So, okay, so landscape is a big one. Then you come to your, is it rural or is it urban? So if you're talking about a place, are you talking about, when it's not just Maharashtra, are you talking about Mumbai, which is the financial capital, or are you talking about Vidarbha, which is hit by drought most of the time? So you are looking at rural or urban. You can have a flourishing rural space also, and you can have an extremely dark, miserable sort of urban space. So it's not that because it's rural and urban, one is good and the other is not. It's just a matter of what you're choosing for your story. So you have rural or urban, and in urban, what, where? Is it in a building? Is it in a mall? Is it on the street? Is it in the backyards? Is it in the ghettos? Is it in the slums? Where exactly is your story happening? So this is your setting. See, that's quite a lot, isn't it? I'm saying this to you very quickly, but when you actually start writing down, you really need to condense it by using just the right words to make sure that in a few lines or a couple of lines, you quickly tell me about the place, and that will make your story very rich and you are likely to get excellent marks for it. Okay, so great. So you've done this, and now let's come to time. So when we come to time, we are asking many things. What time of the day is it? Is it a sweltering afternoon? in a kind of a shanty where you are sitting and you're a social worker and you're working with poor children? Or is it an extremely cold day in a beautiful place where you notice that some people do not have enough warm clothes? So it can be any kind of story, but you need to give me the time of day, and that's a quick one. And then you have the month. So what month is it? Is it the month of May, the month of October? Is it Christmas season? Is it the festival of lights in India with Diwali all around? See, you can bring this in so quickly into your story. And then that story will suddenly come alive to your readers. One of the things to remember is if you're opening your story with a setting, that setting had better be fabulous. So these are the things that will make it fabulous. Okay? So a celebration of a month, or maybe it is the month of Ramadan and you are in the deserts of Arabia. So it could be anywhere, you can decide. Then you come to the season. Now the season has got its own beauty, isn't it? So when you talk of season, you're talking about trees, you're talking about climate, you're talking about all these little things that again add a wonderful touch. And then finally the weather. So season and weather are closely related if you talk about the climate, but the weather will give you the mood. So let us say, let me read some things to you from here and you'll see what I mean. So when you're talking about the weather, it has a big effect on the mood of the story. The drought in Kutch had lasted for 3 successive years. Even when clouds were sighted, they passed by ignoring the stricken country. The monsoons had, so to speak, forgotten the land. See, this is a parched desert that he's talking about, just waiting for the rains. The run lay like a paralyzed monster, its back covered with scab and scar tissue, which is exactly what the land looks like. So it's an exciting description. Another one, but there were no downpours that year. Clouds gathered to the horizon, but they were white and puffy and soon disappeared. So you'll have another description. The weather plays a big part. It creates a mood. Now, when you talk about the run lying there like a big monster, cracked and scabbed, its back full of disease, see the imagery of disease, automatically your mood is not going to be celebratory. It is one of, it's going to make it stark, right? So that's what happens there. The genre will naturally be a serious genre. It's not going to be a funny one, and you set a tone for your story. So that's what setting does with the weather. Weather is an excellent one to use. Then we come to history. Now, when you come to history, as I said, if you put a touch of the political and social conditions, suddenly that story becomes, gets a context. So where is your story set? Is it set during the times of war? Is it set during the times of intrigue, where there are spies who are traveling with notes? Is it during the independence movement of India? Is it during the election time? So there is a certain kind of chaos. There is a certain sort of instability. Are there riots? Are you in the middle of a riot? So what's your political condition? You might want to have a think. It's not absolutely necessary that you put this, but I'm just giving you ideas. So if you say, I don't know what to do with setting, let me just say, oh, I stood and it was a very hot day and the sun was shining and then I looked at the beach. This is a blah setting. This doesn't tell you anything. It has no richness. It has no life. But if you start putting some of these things, it becomes absolutely stunning. Social. So what do we, when we say social, what do we mean? We mean, again, like the celebrations that will add color. You can talk about the locales. What is a locale? Locale meaning, what is the scenario out there? What kind of a space are we talking about? Is there a mela that is happening where everyone is in a state of celebration there? Everyone, children are laughing and there are kind of munching on local sweetmeats, or they are licking their lollies. You can decide what you want to do, the culture, the food, the language, the clothes, the music, all of these are like magic when you come to setting. So you've got your social bits there. So political and social will give you a historical flavor to your story, and that is invaluable. Okay. So we've done this. Let's look at what we've got in the book. So for political and social conditions, as I've said here, the story could be set in the Victorian times or in Japan during World War II or in a fashionable street in Manhattan. And from the from Bella Fleece Gives a Party by Evelyn Waugh, there is a quote that I'd like to read to you. And in all these works, Bella was indefatigable. She trotted from the drawing room to the hall, down the long gallery, up the staircase, admonishing the hireling servants, lending a hand with lighter objects of furniture. So it's set inside a house, see? And you get to see her house from the inside. On the other hand, it could be something completely different. The camp was about 20 kilometers from the main Kabul highway and about 50 kilometers southwest of the Arghandab Dam. The Russians occupied Kandahar, but their hold on the southern capital was tenuous and the city was subject to recurring sieges. So here it's a war scenario. There it was the beautiful, rich house of a lady who had hireling servants. So the choice of words that you use in a setting must give you the flavor of that place immediately. Okay. Now we come to, so we finished this. And as I said, you will have genres. I'll give you a quick understanding of the genres here. Now, depending upon what kind of story you're choosing to write, your setting will slightly change. Okay. Now, if you have the same setting, you need to change the mood. So let's look at Detective Rathod, who is trying to hide and who's trying to shoot somebody in the forest. So in a mystery story, you would say Detective Rathod turned the dark corner and flattened himself against a stone wall in the building. His hand tightened on the gun with anticipation as the masked man he had been chasing suddenly moved. The copse of trees provided excellent shelter. So this is a very serious mystery story he's chasing. The same thing if it was a comedy, you would say, Detective Rathod stumbled round the dark corner. See, comedy, stumbled round the dark corner and flattened himself nose to the wall. Now he's standing like this, so it's rather funny, smiling inwardly over his cunning plan. It reminds you of Mr. Bean. Realizing his folly, that he shouldn't be standing to the wall, he should be standing away from the wall, he righted himself quickly, took aim at the shape. So he held his hand up with confidence, planning to raise it down like this and shoot. But then what happened to him was there was a hook on top of his head and his gun got stuck in that hook. See, so the story has changed. The same setting, but we've changed the story because it's a comedy. So I'm just trying to give you some idea of how you might change the settings. Let's come to descriptive phrasing. You've got a lot of great descriptive phrasing that comes in. So when you describe the roads as the treacherous marshy roads, or you talk about the reprehensible pre-monsoon heat, or the cocooned by the velvet of the night. So you are creating romance there, or you're creating the delirious dance of rain on the asphalt pavement. So if you have a scenario where it's so hot that you're waiting for the rain, it would be a delirious dance of the rain. So by using fantastic words or kissed by the moist rain-laden clouds, you're using descriptive phrasing. I'm just giving you a sample of how you can use descriptive phrasing. And then we come to the senses. Don't forget the senses. So the tools that you've got are descriptive phrasing, like I just showed you. Choose your words very cleverly. The second one is the five senses. Any place that you are in, you actually understand that place with your five senses. And so what do you have? You have color. Now don't use it was black, brown, green, gray kind of thing. If you used, if you would describe the sea as aquamarine, or you describe the sky as cerulean, you'll suddenly find that there is a certain magical touch in your writing. So color, take tertiary colors. Sounds, onomatopoeia, if you, because you're always hearing things when you go to places. It might be the music of an you know, an itinerant tribe. It could be the clanging of machines in a place where they are digging up something. It could be the eerie silence of a street on a cold night. It can be any of these, right? So therefore, sounds are important. Food and taste go together. So if you bring in food, it can be quite magical. Smell is related to memories and to nostalgia. Smells always trigger memory. So if you talk about what sort of memories that place triggers in terms of smells, you'll add again a lot of life into your, an authenticity into your story. Movement and stillness is another one. So there can be a lot of movement, or there can be complete stillness, or you can alternate between those and your setting becomes fantastic. Your diction can be positive or negative. So the same place, depending upon how you describe, changes. So I could say a large house stood on the edge of a massive cliff, okay? Or I could say the ancient house stood on the edge of a lonely cliff. Now, massive cliff and lonely cliff. See, the mood changes slightly. When I say lonely, suddenly it becomes far away and inaccessible. Massive cliff just looks majestic, right? So, I'm just reading one line for you. And that makes a lot of difference. The diction, what sort of tone are you using? That will affect the atmosphere in your story. Very, very good for ghost stories. If you're writing a ghost story, very important that you build up atmosphere. Now we come to similes. That's the third one. So if you use similes, then I can see the picture. The important thing is to show me that setting. And you're not going to show me that setting if you say, you know, the place was absolutely brilliant. I mean, it was fantastic. I mean, it was so good that I never wanted to leave it. You can go on like this and I will never know what you're talking about. But if you give me similes, if you tell me like what, like a familiar experience that I've had. So if you're talking about a long road that you're driving on and it seems like you're going to go on forever and ever, if you tell me the tarmac road stretched like a black tongue, what happens? It gives it a certain, an eerie feeling, like a black tongue. I can feel that sense of driving on and on and on a road that looks like a black tongue. I can actually feel it in my head, and that's what you need to do. Or the shimmering air was like a breath, like the breath of an oven. So everyone has opened ovens and felt the air. So I know exactly the kind of climate you're talking about. So similes are fantastic tools in order to get your descriptions right. So I think I've given you so much on setting. If you write, if you think about all this and write it, trust me, you'll have to think about how to make it less, because it's so much that you'll now have to say, how can I cut it down? But you know what, when you're writing, when you're practicing essays, I don't mean in an exam sitting and writing this for the first time, but when you give, when you have practice with writing in your schools or colleges, or even when if they are not assignments, if you start writing settings like this, you will be so good at it that you will actually be able to write it in a few lines. So if you like this lesson, press that like button, subscribe to my channel, give me my comments, go and look at my website. And it's got Writing with Ease, this book. I've done this entire lesson from this book. So you might want to buy it from my website. So till we meet again, Take care and keep practicing.